Where did the Mr. Handy Robots really come from? Well, the confusion comes in when reading up on the Mr. Handys using the Fallout Wiki. As of this recording, the wiki says that the Mr. Handy was created as part of a joint project between two different companies, General Atomics International and Robco Industries. Now, we have to remember that the wiki is open to the public. Anyone can contribute to it. It's a reliable source of information, but sometimes it gets things wrong. Most of the time, however, the wiki will cite its sources, and we can look up those sources to read the information directly from the game or the source material. But in this case, there is no source. The wiki makes this claim without backing it up. Is this true? Was it really created by two different companies? And if so, why? Robco is competent enough to create a series of its own robots. They created the Protectron, the iBot, the SentryBot. Why would they need another company's help to create a Mr. Handy? Similarly, although the Mr. Handy is General Atomics' first foray into the whole robot scene, they have built a successful company creating other consumer goods.
Another fine product of General Atomics International.
So why would they need Robco's help to create a Mr. Handy? Well, I wanted to solve this issue. So the first place I went to was the General Atomics factory in Fallout 4. We come here as part of the Automatron quests, and when we arrive, it's filled with a bunch of robots from The Mechanist. I covered this place in detail in my video on the topic, but it's easy to learn exactly what went on here. On the walls of the factory, on every single floor, are a big Miss Nanny posters. New generation model, the XT-15 Mrs. Nanny. A softer touch. Indeed, if we go to the factory floor, we find Mr. Handy or Mrs. Nanny parts on the conveyor belts. We don't find parts from any other robots. We don't see washers, dryers, other consumer goods. We only see these Mr. Handy parts. Also, if we have X688 as a companion, while exploring this factory, he offhandedly says,
"It seems likely that the robots at Grey Garden were produced here."
I know that was hard to hear. I wasn't expecting him to say this. I tried to get him to say it again, but I couldn't. But he said, "It seems likely that the robots at Grey Garden were produced here." And I have to agree with him. They're making the Mrs. Nannies right now, but this is clearly a factory designed to produce Mr. Handy-style robots owned by General Atomics. And we all know that the robots at Grey Garden are all Mr. Handys. On the bottom floor, we see an experiment set up, which we get to go through the first time we explore this building. The experiment is to test the Mrs. Handy robots to see how well they can care for a human child. We go through things like giving it a bottle, punishing the child, and the official Fallout 4 strategy guide confirms this. Even though General Atomics abandoned this factory as civil unrest heightened across the country, when active, it specialized Mrs. Nanny robots. It's interesting to note that while the posters in the factory spell the model name Mrs. Handy, M-R-S Handy, in the Fallout guide, it's spelled M-S Handy, which is pronounced Ms. So it looks like either usage could be correct. Well, we can follow this up by going to the General Atomics Galleria, and we can see the place from a distance. The great feature of this place, towering above all else, is the big Mr. Handy statue in the middle of the Galleria. There's an arch above the entrance that says General Atomics, and the greeter tells us the purpose of this Galleria.
"Our wide array of stores are staffed entirely by the General Atomics line of robots, showcasing the reliability and versatility of a robotic workforce."
Every single shop is run by a Mr. Handy robot. The guards are Mr. Handy robots. The director whom we meet at the top of the statue during the course of this quest is a Mr. Handy robot. This is part of a pretty compelling case that General Atomics made the Mr. Handy. This is confirmed even again when we meet Codsworth for the first time upon returning to Sanctuary.
"But of course I'm still here. Surely you don't think a little radiation could deter the pride of General Atomics International?"
Well, this all seems pretty straightforward, right? General Atomics made the Mr. Handy robot. So wherein lies the confusion? How could the wiki get this wrong? Well, if we go to talk with Supervisor White at Grey Garden, she says something interesting.
"We supervisors, that is myself, Green and Brown, possess sophisticated cognition processors. We are capable of complex analysis and decision-making. A testament to the genius of our creator, Dr. Edward Gray.
I remember him. He was one of Robco's senior engineers, but more than a little eccentric.
That's the second time you've said that you remember something before the war. I think you're a little confused, darling. You simply can't have been alive back then.
Huh. She doesn't correct him here. The sole survivor says that Dr. Gray was one of Robco's senior engineers, and Supervisor White says that Dr. Gray was her creator. And not only her creator, but the creator of the other Mr. Handys here at Gray Garden. So what's a scientist from Robco, Robco being a completely different company, doing creating a Mr. Handy robot which supposedly was created by General Atomics? Now maybe we're just misunderstanding her. Maybe when she says that Dr. Gray from Robco created her, she's not talking about her robot body. Maybe she's talking about her mind. Maybe all Edward Gray did was program her, and she sees that programming as her creation. After all, her personality is more her than her robot arms are, right? Well, that's a plausible explanation, but let's dig a little deeper, see what we can find. I wanted to go to the very beginning, so I took a look at the game manual that came with Fallout 1. The only reference to General Atomics I found was a reference to the nuclear power backup system for Vault 13. So the company, General Atomics International, was referred to even in the very first Fallout game, but in that game, there's no mention of them creating robots. Now, there are Mr. Handys in Fallout 1, but we don't get a lot of information on them. And of course, they appear in Fallout 2. But the blurb on Mr. Handys in the Fallout 2 strategy guide doesn't say who made them. I even scoured the manuals and strategy guides for Fallout Tactics as well, and there's no information. One of the most important pieces of evidence we get is the Mr. Handy design document written by Chris Taylor, the lead designer of Fallout 1 and a producer of Fallout Tactics, published on September 21st, 2007, in celebration of the 10th anniversary of Fallout 1. This document included details about the Mr. Handy robot, as well as some original concept art. It was released online, but also published with a bonus CD along with the game Fallout Tactics. It's not a highly polished publication, but we learn a lot of system specs about the robot, as well as some important historical information, including that the robot was first brought to market in 2037 by General Atomics International. Now, you'd think this would put the argument to rest, right? After all, Robert House, the man who created the company Robco, was born in 2020. That would have made him only 17 years old in the year 2037 when General Atomics first brought Mr. Handy robots to market. Even though Robert House was a boy genius, 2037 is still 5 years before he created his own company, Robco, which he founded on June 25th, 2042. So clearly, there's no way Robco could have created Mr. Handy, which matches perfectly with the information we learned in Fallout 4 when exploring the General Atomics buildings. Right? Well, in Fallout 3, when we head to the Capital Wasteland, we find the Robco facility. We come here when doing Moira Brown's Wasteland Survival Guide quest. And immediately upon entry, we see a bunch of Protectrons, not Mr. Handys. Okay, so Robco made Protectrons. Sadly, none of these plaques by any of these Protectrons are functional, they don't say anything. But we see even here in Fallout 3 that Robco had a tight relationship with Nuka-Cola. One of their display Protectron models even sports a Nuka-Cola paint job. And we see that they've got a tight relationship with the military. The other one on display has a military paint job. But we know that Robco's Protectrons are not designed just for corporations or the military. We see them in use in metro stations, taking tickets, as vendors, basically as a replacement for any type of human labor or customer service. While exploring the Robco factory in Fallout 3, we see lots of Protectrons and no other robots. Now, this, of course, isn't evidence that Robco didn't make the Mr. Handy. It could simply be that this factory was focused on Protectrons. I then went to the Fallout 3 official strategy guide to confirm this. You know that robot deputy right outside Megaton, Deputy Weld? Well, the strategy guide says right here that Deputy Weld is a Robco Industries Protectron robot who guards the entrance to Megaton. So there you go. But wait a minute, directly above this entry, is an entry on Deputy Steel. This Robco Industries Mr. Gutsy has been programmed to serve as an assistant to Sheriff Sims. Wait a minute. Mr. Gutsy robots are Mr. Handys that have been outfitted to serve in the military. The only differences between a Mr. Handy and a Mr. Gutsy is the paint scheme, the weapons it has, and the voice it has. If General Atomics made the Mr. Handy, why does this guide say that Robco made the Mr. Gutsy? That doesn't make any sense. One way we could try to explain this is that maybe Robco purchased Mr. Handys from General Atomics. Since Robco has such a tight relationship with the military and likely provided the military with most of its robots, maybe what Robco did is write the military software for the Mr. Handy robots. Give it a military personality, give it military-grade weapons, and then sell the new Mr. Gutsies, made from Mr. Handys, to the military. I suppose if that's the way it happened, the Fallout 3 strategy guide could get away with describing Deputy Steel and Mr. Gutsy as a Robco industry robot. Still, I feel like something's missing. Next, we need to move on to Fallout New Vegas to see what information we can find there. And the first stop we need to make is over at the Repcon test facility. But wait, Repcon made rockets. They didn't focus on robot technology. Why would we be visiting the Repcon test site? Well, while exploring the Repcon test site, we read a number of terminals where we learn that Robco acquired Repcon in a hostile takeover. Robco, which already had great success due to their Pip-Boy and their terminals and their robots, was now wanting to move into the rocket business. And instead of starting from square one, they figured they would just acquire Repcon. Repcon had already made great strides, produced a number of rockets, but the founders didn't want to sell, and so Robert House had to play some dirty tricks to take over the company, which are all explained in the terminals we find here. To follow this up, we can travel to the Repcon headquarters here in Fallout New Vegas. But wait a minute. Patrolling the area outside of the Repcon headquarters are Mr. Handy maintenance robots. What are Mr. Handy maintenance robots doing at Repcon? If Robco bought Repcon, as we learned, shouldn't these be Protectrons? Things get even more confusing when we talk with the Mr. Handy tour guide. He tells us very briefly about the acquisition.
Robco Industries purchased Repcon in 2075 to assist with some of Robco's military projects, as well as developing unmanned space exploration. The relationship between Robco and Repcon is mutually beneficial, and we hope that both companies bolster each other well into the next century.
And then he offers to take us on a tour. When we go through the tour, he points out a lot of stuff concerning Repcon's achievements before they were acquired by Robco. But one wing of this tiny museum is dedicated to Robco's robots.
Now for the highlight of our tour. Due to a generous donation from Robco, this next exhibit showcases the wondrous world of robots. Around you are the incredible iBot, the fearsome SentryBot, and the always helpful Mr. Handy. That helpfulness runs through our whole line.
There are four robots on display here, each with its own plaque, and we see all of the regulars that we're used to. The iBot, the SentryBot, the Protectron, even though this one's a modified Protectron, and then, over in the corner, a Mr. Handy. You never can have too many hands. Three, why not four? That was Robco's inspiration behind the popular and cost-effective Mr. Handy model, the first of the line shown here. Well, this is just throwing all of our theories out the window. It says right here that wanting to give a robot a lot of hands was Robco's inspiration for creating the Mr. Handy robot. That goes far beyond simply upgrading a Mr. Handy's software to turn it into a Mr. Gutsy, or upgrading its weapons to become military grade. This is telling us that Robco created the Mr. Handy robot. But this is frustrating because we already know that General Atomics made the Mr. Handy robot. We saw the factory in Fallout 4. We were told as much when we visited the Galleria. How can both of these be true at the same time? Well, you know what? We learned that Robco had a cozy relationship with Nuka-Cola. Maybe we can learn more if we visit the Robco Battle Zone in Nuka World. Now, the Robco Battle Zone is inside the Star Control. And as we approach Star Control, we see a bunch of ruined robots, one of which is called a Mr. Frothy, which bears a striking resemblance to a Mr. Handy. It's quite possible that Nuka-Cola could have hired General Atomics to create the Mr. Frothy robot based on their Mr. Handy model, but why would they if they already had a working relationship with Robco? Heading deeper inside, we find an attraction called Handy Whirl. This looks a lot like the big statue at the General Atomics Galleria, only this one's been converted into a ride. The Mr. Handy arms are attached to seats, which spin around in a big circle. Well, this gives me an impression that maybe Nuka-Cola really did reach out to General Atomics. And right across from this ride is the Robco Battle Zone. This is where spectators would buy tickets to sit down and watch a bunch of robots battle each other to death. Now, the robots we find here are Protectrons and Assaultrons and iBots, no Mr. Handys. Now, these are all slightly modified versions, and this is alluded to in the terminal up in the control room. One of the entries says that some of the complaints they got from spectators are that the robots that fight in this arena are too similar to Robco's Protectron and Assaultron models. The spectators felt robbed. They came here to see never-before-seen Robco prototypes instead of the more standard robots that they were already familiar with. The pre-war world was very familiar with the line of robots that Robco produced, and heading down to the basement we see even more on display, many in their charging docks, and in the middle of the room one big sentry bot. All of the robots Robco are famous for, but no Mr. Handys. So now I feel like we've gone full circle. If Robco created the Mr. Handy, you would think that there would be a Mr. Handy in this battle zone. I think we can explain the Mr. Frothys outside simply by saying that Nuka-Cola had relationships with a wide range of companies, both Robco and General Atomics. There is one final place in Fallout 4 where we can go to see if we can resolve this mystery. Near to the Boston airport is the Robco Sales and Service Center. Now remember, Robco does a lot more than just make robots. They made the Pip-Boy, and they made all of the terminals that we see. This Sales and Service Center was primarily for their terminal business. Inside, we see a display floor with a bunch of terminals on display that visitors could have browsed through when choosing the computer of their choice. It's interesting to note that we do see some robot parts on the ground, and they are Protectron parts only. This must be the remains of a security guard that has long since been destroyed. We see two Protectron charging docks as we walk around back to this service room, and this is where the employees worked on the terminals. But as we know, if we installed Automatron, this Robco Sales and Service Center had a secret basement. This secret basement leads to an underground facility where the military made the RoboBrain. The first skeleton we see upon entry is wearing a military uniform. So this makes perfect sense. We already know that Robco works closely with the military. But deep inside this facility, when we get to the mechanist's lair, we find a button on the side of a coffee machine that opens up a secret room in the back. Here we find the observation terminal. And inside the observation terminal, we learned that Robco was not in charge here. Today marks the first official meeting of the minds within the new facility. General Rawlings met with the representatives from General Atomics, Anna Karim, and Gregory Alder. I firmly believe that having the US military working side by side with these brilliant scientists will yield some amazing results. So, wait a minute. The US military was working with General Atomics to create the RoboBrains, but this entire secret RoboBrain production facility was underneath a Robco Sales and Service Center? Why then would they work with General Atomics and not Robco? What's Robco doing agreeing to be a front for a covert military production facility partnered with their direct competition, General Atomics? We learn by continuing to read these terminals that the General Atomics scientists didn't understand what they were getting into. When the military started bringing in a bunch of captive prisoners, the General Atomics people started to get nervous. In response, the military put them on watch. We see two General Atomics scientists named specifically. As we continue to explore this facility, we do find a lot of Robco Protectron parts lying around. We even see some spilling out of a wing to the building called Parts Warehouse. Okay, so this place made RoboBrains. It was run by a bunch of scientists from General Atomics, which made Mr. Handys. But in the parts warehouse, we find Protectron parts made by Robco? And in the facility's management wing, we find a terminal that lists a bunch of repair orders. One of the orders was to fix a Protectron. It had some voice distortion. But the very next one is to fix a G421 Mr. Gutsy. It had no optic readings from the center eye stalk. It needs replacement. This may be explained when we reach the production control terminal. Here we learn that the military brought in a man named Lieutenant Justin Green to take over production control. As soon as he arrived, he got extremely angry at all of the General Atomics scientists who had been running the place. He was angry because they were only operating at 90% efficiency. He managed to get rid of every single General Atomics scientist working here and replaced them all with military personnel. By the end of the terminal, he brags that he got the facility working up to 100% efficiency. He ends by saying, "Stick that in your pipe and smoke it, General Atomics." So maybe at one point, the military decided to work with General Atomics just to make the RoboBrain. But after the General Atomics scientists became uncomfortable ripping the brains out of living prisoners and sticking them into robots, the military fired the General Atomics scientists and just took over the entire facility. Here, they repaired other robots in their arsenal, including the ones they got from Robco, like the Protectrons. That would explain the wide array of robot parts we find here from both companies. But we still don't have any evidence backing up what the wiki claims. The wiki said that the Mr. Handy was created as part of a joint project between General Atomics and Robco. But so far, all we've found is conflicting information, each company claiming to be the creator of the Mr. Handy. Well, the closest thing I could find to resolve this situation is if we head back to Fallout 3 and visit the Citadel. The Citadel, as we know, is the remains of the Pentagon in Washington, D.C. that the Brotherhood of Steel have taken over and turned into their headquarters. If we head on inside and we go down into the laboratory, we see a bunch of scientists at work and the big, towering form of Liberty Prime, surrounded by scaffolding in the middle of the room. On the Liberty Prime operations terminal, directly in front of it, we see an article on historical records. If we check out the project summary, we learned that the military's goal here was to create the most powerful combat robot the battlefield has ever seen. In order to do so, the United States Army has succeeded in contracting both Robco and General Atomics International to work on their first joint project. This, I think, puts the final nail in the coffin on the idea that Mr. Handy was a creation of a joint project between Robco and General Atomics. Not only was the very first Mr. Handy brought to market 5 years before Robco the company was even founded by Robert House, but this terminal entry was likely written on or around June 3rd, 2072. That's the date we find on other entries on this terminal. If this was the first project that Robco and General Atomics worked on together, then that means that the Mr. Handy robot would have been commercially available for 35 years before the two companies came together to work on Liberty Prime. There's no way that Liberty Prime could be their first joint project if they previously made the Mr. Handy together 5 years before Robco was even founded. So, where does this leave us? Well, I hate to say it, but it leaves us with a continuity error. A continuity error spanning the entire franchise. It appears in Fallout 3, it appears in Fallout New Vegas, it appears in Fallout 4. I think that the canonical story of the Mr. Handy robot came from the design document published by Chris Taylor. This says that the Mr. Handy was created in 2037 by General Atomics. I can understand why people made this continuity error, because the Mr. Handy robot is such an iconic robot of the Fallout universe, and it makes a lot of sense that it would have been made by Robco. Yes, Robco is named after Robert House, but the name Robco makes you think of robot. Quest designers and writers for the games likely made this mistake very innocently, thinking that the most iconic robot in the game, the Mr. Handy, would have been made by Robco, the company that made all other robots in the franchise, except for the RoboBrain and half of Liberty Prime. But despite these continuity errors made earlier in the game, I think Bethesda wanted to recognize what Chris Taylor said in the document that he published by making sure to place General Atomics atop every Mr. Handy factory in Fallout 4. So I'm gonna say that the wiki is wrong. I think that very clever Fallout fans were trying to find a way to explain away this continuity error by claiming that it was a joint venture between the two companies. But as we've already seen, it could never have been a joint venture because the Mr. Handy was created 5 years before Robco even became a company. And yeah, that's disappointing. I always dislike seeing continuity errors like this pop up in my favorite books, movies, or games. But you know what? People are human. These things happen. And I can still enjoy Fallout despite the error. But what are your thoughts? Is this a big deal to you? Does this spoil the entire game for you? Or do you think my assessment is wrong and that it's not really a continuity error? That it really still could have been a joint venture between General Atomics and Robco? I would love to hear your opinions. Let me know your thoughts in the comments section below. I've got a brand new shirt in the shop, folks. Suspender set to maximum stun. That's right, I figured it was about time I had a shirt related to my show, Scotch and Smoke Rings. On the front, we've got the quote, and on the back, we've got my smiling mug. It comes in a variety of shirts, mugs, a wide range of colors. You can find a link to the shop in the description below or by clicking here. Thank you all so much for watching. If you like what I do and you want to support me in a more personal way, consider becoming one of my patrons on Patreon. But more than anything, I'm just so glad you're here watching this video with me today. Thank you so much for watching, and I'll see you tomorrow morning, bright and early, with a brand new video.